This video is for students who are looking for some elaboration on and modeling of the contextualization tool. Just so you are aware, this tool and the skills and methods demonstrated here can be applied to virtually any source you may come across in a history class. But for the purposes of this video, we will be using the materials in day 21 of Unit 1, the objective of which is for students to be able to write a paragraph in which they identify and explain the historical circumstances that led to the creation of the Alien and Sedition Acts, as well as the indictment of Matthew Lyon. Let's start off by talking about what contextualization is. And I think these two reminders up here at the top are going to be very useful to us, namely considering all the forces that acted upon the person, group, or event that we're looking at, and also thinking of contextualization as a very short version of a very long story. Now, when we use this word forces, we mean things like influences. Probably the easiest way to think about this is by asking yourself, what influenced or led to this happening? And it likely isn't just one thing. It was probably numerous people, individuals, big events, small events, intermediate ones, and others that were more distant. And all these forces came together, resulting in the person, group, or event that you are looking at. And like it says right here, whenever we think about history, we naturally contextualize it. And once you're aware of all these things, and you've practiced this process several times, you can actually train your brain to determine what is relevant to the context, and you will kind of automatically filter out what isn't, and you'll be left with a much shorter version. This tool is going to help you practice this until you get to the point where it's not even necessary anymore. Let's start with a walkthrough of the components and sequence of this tool, then we'll apply it to constructing a historical context for the Alien and Sedition Acts, along with Matthew Lyons' indictment. In this first box, we must first identify the event, the person, or the group. That is the subject of our work. This is where you will note some of the more basic information, such as the location, the important dates, as well as recording a brief description about what you already know about it. And this box, it can just be a sentence or two, or even some bullet points. The next step is to consider the forces that acted upon what we're contextualizing, and it does actually help to look at them as being part of two very different categories. We have the distant view, which are kind of the longer term forces that acted upon the person, group, or event, and we also have the immediate view, which are the ones that happen closer to the time of it occurring. And like it says up here, you should consider the immediate view first and then look for the longer story, because the more distant ones, they're usually harder to identify, and usually the immediate ones can give us some clues or insight as to what they might be. For each type of force, and you can see their names right here, we have intellectual, socioeconomic, political, and geographic. You are provided also with questions that are meant to guide you through the process of gathering relevant information. And when you are actually going through this process and trying to differentiate between what distinguishes distant from immediate, I'm going to give you the same advice that I give my own students, and that's to view this as kind of looking as though it was a book. The immediate forces are what are going to be on the same page as the event we're contextualizing, or maybe a few pages before, but that's it. When you are gathering information for the distant view, the longer term things, this is where you want to review the whole chapter and look for trends that existed over time that even allowed for the intermediate ones to even exist. I'll provide an example of what I mean as we go through the model in just a few moments. On the second page of this tool are the spaces for you to enter your findings, synthesize your information, and actually construct your context down below. And for those of you that are doing this in a virtual classroom, this is what's going to be on the slides that you're working on. So now let's get to the model, and I'm actually going to do it in the slide version so it's easier for me to enter text for you to see and follow along with. Again, this lesson happens to be about contextualizing the Alien and Sedition Acts, and yours might be different, but remember, the process and skills are basically going to be the same. In this specific lesson, though, we started off by watching these two videos, which is what we use to complete the first step, which is just kind of the basic contextualization information. And if you're using this tool on another historical topic, you can easily find your own introductory sources to get this basic information, whether it's a general overview video like the ones in this lesson, or even a tertiary source like an online encyclopedia. And here's a model of what mine turned out being, let me move this up, based on that, you know, the two videos from this lesson. We then read a secondary source titled John Adams and the Alien and Sedition Acts, which you can see right here, to provide us with more of the information we need for the immediate and distant views. Even if I was doing this in an actual classroom with pens and paper, I would still have it set up on my desk just like you see it here, the tool next to the reading, because me seeing them next to each other will guide me as to what I am looking for as I read this text. Also, like I'll show in a moment, I really do find the guiding questions helpful when determining what is immediate versus what is a distant view. Now, if you are doing this lesson, the next step is for you to read the secondary source, and you should annotate for all of these forces for both types of views as you do. Because I like to keep my thoughts organized, I would even annotate based on this color scheme. If you're doing this as part of a different lesson, at this point you should locate and read a secondary source that will give you ample background information. So pause the video here and go ahead and do that, and when you return, I'll display my model for this specific lesson. So now that your secondary source background reading is done and annotated, here is what mine turned out to look like. And since I took the time to color code all the different factors that I identified, it is really easy for me to flip back and forth as I enter them into this section of the tool. But sometimes I do still struggle to decide whether it's an immediate or a distant view, and this is where I refer back to those guiding questions. For example, when I was considering the socioeconomic factors such as the tumult and fear that was gripping society, as well as the 25,000 French immigrants, I did refer back to the questions in the tool for both of these forces. And after reading these questions, as well as this one up here, I did determine that the growing fear of war with France was definitely more of an immediate view, so I placed that up here. But the 25,000 immigrants was more likely of a long-term impact on the social structure, which led me to classify it as a more distant element, and that's why it's down here in this box. Also, I want to make clear that you will not always find things to enter into each of these categories. You will see that so far I still have two that are blank, and that's okay. Every source won't always have something for each of them. After we've gotten everything we can from that secondary source, it's always good to find a reliable primary source that is both useful and accurate, which would add insight to our understanding of the event we're contextualizing. And all you need to do is add to the work you already started in each of these categories. What I recommend to my own students is that they add a quick little symbol for themselves so they know where they got each entry from, so they can keep their notes organized, and that's also going to help them reference specific texts later on when they're actually writing their context. Since this lesson only had one primary and one secondary source, I just used the P and an S. And if you wanted to include something from one of the videos, all you would have to do is add like a V or something like that. You should now go read a primary source related to what you're contextualizing. It may be provided by your teacher as part of a lesson, or you can try finding one on your own, and feel free to pause here and return after it's read and annotated. Again, for the purposes of this video, let's assume that I just read and annotated the primary source associated with this lesson about the Alien and Sedition Acts, which happens to be something called the Indictment of Matthew Lyon, and my model ended up looking like this. Now remember, you won't always find all four components in each text, and with this one, I only found these two. I found political and intellectual forces. Then I'm going to add them to the work I've already done, and you'll see here that I did label them correctly with a P. The next part requires you to synthesize relevant information from all of these parts into a cohesive paragraph, which is going to be your context. And you should think of all your work here as being puzzle pieces, and now you just need to figure out how they go together. Like it says here, to do a thorough job of this, you not only want a combination of different forces, but also you want a balance between the immediate and distant views. I would again pause this video here and try this on your own, and come back and unpause if you'd like to compare yours to a model that I made based on what we've done in this video so far. My advice, which you can see I demonstrate here in this model, is to start with the contextualization information that you gathered in step one, because it includes the relevant information, names, dates, as well as defining any relevant terms that are going to help frame the event. Then I transition to some of the more distant factors. And finally, I do get into some of the more immediate ones, like specifically the case of Matthew Lyon, which I did get from that primary source.